student, and also have lunch with my professor, with my students. And I remember one of my professor's favorite format is not just, you know, have lunch together. We also went to a bar having drinks.
My apologies. We'll work on that later.
Well, I'm not a drinker, so,
Did you really study in an MFA program then?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Just a few words about myself. Some you have already mentioned. I was born in China, and I started writing in Chinese, and I publish poetry in Chinese, translation Chinese. So in 1988, I got Ford Foundation Fellowship. So my plan was to come to the States for 1 year, do some research about T.S. Eliot. I translate almost all his poems into Chinese, and then be back, you know, to write a critical biography about the poet. But before 1 year was over, the Tiananmen crackdown happened, and I somehow got into trouble. So I could not go back. I had a collection of my own poetry. I already read the proof, but the publisher told me no, it could not be published. And that's also why I switched to writing English. I like one particular English word, accidental. So in a way, a lot of things about my writing, about my life, you know, was and is accidental. I did not plan to write in English. I did not plan to write in Mr. Yang either, because for many years I was unable to go back to China for the reason I mentioned. So for the first time I went back, I was really impressed, with the change, change in China nowadays. So I thought I should write something about it, try my hand on a novel for the first time. But I have not done fiction before. So I really had a hard time putting my material together. So in that sense, mystery or crime writing came to my rescue. I love crime writing. And for me, this is something like a ready-made framework. With mystery, you always have a body at the beginning, right? And then you have to find who done it and all, the investigation. And then, of course, you have a conclusion. So it's like a structure. I thought I could try to put what I want to say into this particular framework. My original intention was to write a novel, not a mystery, a novel about the Chinese society in transition. But it somehow evolved or accidentally into a mystery. And when I give the manuscript to my American publisher, first American publisher, I was not even sure what book it is. Maybe it's a novel, maybe it's a mystery. But she said to me, well, it's good mystery, and we want to publish it, and we also want to sign a contract with you for 3 books. I did not have agent. Even today, I still don't have agent. So I was flattered, right? It was the first time try, and 3 book contract I signed, and then kind of came the trouble, because you have to write the second one in the theory and the third one. So right now, I think I finished 10 books in the series and working on number 11. And I still get letters from my readers don't kill your inspector yet. And so, because he's in more and more in trouble, that is true. So sometimes I cannot help think about such a conclusion for the whole series. So, but with so many things still happening there, so he may still work a little bit more, okay? Now you just mentioned about different genres and in my writing, and I said, you know, mystery is not a genre that I set out to write. Mm-hmm. So maybe from the very beginning, there is this kind of accidental, you know, combination of novel, mm-hmm. or realistic novel with, you know, Mr. Zhang. And also because before that, I only wrote poetry. And also maybe, as you know, in classic Chinese novels, there are a lot of poetry, much more poetry than, you know, in my inspection novels. Often, like, you know, at the beginning of a chapter, you have a poem. At the end of the chapter, you have another poem. And I kind of like it, because I think, you know, when you do sometimes narrative, need different lyrical intensity, right? Yeah. It's just like Shakespeare. Sometimes you do blank verse. And so again, I thought, well, I may try my hand on that, you know, introduce some poems into my fiction. And again, it's quite accidental, because my publisher at first was a little bit worried. We don't have a detective writing poetry. So whether it will work out or not, we don't know, but we decided we give it a try. And I think to her surprise, to my surprise as well, she got quite a lot of letters from readers. You know, we love the poetry in the novel. So, okay, we stick with that. And also, I think another thing I've been trying to do is, just as you have mentioned, experimenting a little bit about, you know, writing cross genres. Like my latest book, the French version has came out. It's, I think the French title is called Once Upon Time Inspection. So it's like combining some autobiographical stories or anecdote with the earlier story about inspection, or even before he becomes a cop. So I think, you know, some European publisher really like it. I'm going to, you know, to France again this March about this book. But some publisher are kind of still hesitating, like my American publisher, no, it's not exactly mystery book, right? So, but I love the idea, you know, experimenting, so I'm still...
And it seems like kind of a mystery, because you've written enough books that your writers are curious about who you are and what of you is in the books already, so then you give them this book where it says, you know, where you say that some of it is about you, and they're guessing, well, which parts exactly are true, right?
Yeah, you're
so
right.
So that's
you're
a
right.
mystery, right? It just doesn't, fortunately, involve a body.
Well, it involves some body as well. Yeah. But it's, yeah, you're right. It's one of the most common questions I got from my readers, like, you know, how much inspection of you, and how much is just fiction? And you know, at first it's just easy to say, okay, well, I have never been a party member, I have never been a cop, right? But if anything I share with the spectrum, I love poetry, and I love good food. So, but then it's really stymie thinking, you know, this question from readers. It's sometimes the relation, you know, between maybe, you know, just like T.S. Eliot put it, like in his well-known impersonal theory, sometimes you have to separate the person who lives and the author who writes. Of course, in the relation between two influencing each other, but you don't have to identify like, oh, that T.S. Eliot's Wasteland must be based on his personal experience. Of course, he was miserable at the time, but it does not have to be the same, right? So sometimes I think it's fun to explore that a little bit. Another fun project I don't have the copy with me, have recently done, it's I also published a collection of poetry, but under the name of Inspection. And it's, again, it's my French publisher's idea. They say poetry is difficult nowadays. You don't get too much readership. But if we say it's Inspection's poetry, then it can be another story, right?
I sense a trend here, like the poems of Anna Karenina.
Yeah, and I think the works. It works. So it's and but of course they want also me add some notes. You know, this poem has something to do with which novel. Mm-hmm. This poem has something to do with which, you know, murder case. So make this poem more real. Like, and in the book, of course, Inspection also writes poems. Sometimes, you know, quotes poem as well. And I have to admit, one of the reasons, you know, I have poetry in the fiction, it's also because like smuggling poetry into fiction, right? So I continue with that tradition, because that way, maybe more people can read poetry.
And when you put poetry in your novels, you mentioned that in Chinese literature, often there's this preponderance of poetry in a prose work, but how do you look at making use of the poems, other than saying, okay, well, Inspector Chen is a poet in part to gain some perspective, but how are the other ways that the poem functions in these mystery novels?
Several ways. One example in the second novel in what's called A Mortal Dancer, Inspection tries to understand, you know, one suspect and her feeling with another man. So that may help with the investigation. And at the same time, he's also more or less romantically involved with his partner. But at the same time, he realizes it's impossible, okay? Because he is Chinese party member cop, the partner is American officer, right? There's no way they can really come together. So, and I believe, you know, at this juncture, the radical intensity may justify some poem. So originally, I quote one poem by Louis MacNeice. I think it's called The Sunlight Lost on a Garden. It's about, like, you know, two people together. They know they have no future, but nonetheless, you know, grateful for the moment they are together. But the poem was vetoed by my publisher. A lot of T.S. Eliot poem was also vetoed, quoted by my publisher. She says, no, it's too expensive to quote. But, you know, the structure is already there, right? So I said, okay, maybe I can write an imitation.
Right. It's like being a cover band.
And it kind of worked. Yeah. It kind of worked. My UK publisher said, no, we read this original poem. We think your poem is almost as good as the original one. But for me, I think it justifies. And I think in another book, it's also like the poetry really provides some clue to the mystery. So I use that. But I think on the whole, my main character, Inspector, is a bookish man. And he, like me, I have to admit, very bookish and love, you know, to write poems. And in China, in the early, in the 80s, even early 90s, the college graduate were assigned to work by the state, by the government. You did not apply for a job yourself, no. So he was assigned to work as a policeman, not some like you, right? Want to be writers, you know, professors. So there is a tension in this character. So I think sometimes it may work to help, you know. Like, yes, he wants to, you know, to be a poet or to be a writer. But in China, a lot of things are determined by the government. The government wanted what as a cop. So there's tension. But I think it also helps in a sense that kind of give him different perspective to look at the case. One perspective, you certainly can say he's a cop, right? He had to examine the case from the cop's eye. But at the same time, there's still some lingering poet's element in him. So sometimes he look at the case also more like a poet. I think one French author, even though not his character is not poet, sometimes George Simenon, you know, the main character, he's also very sympathetic, even toward the murderer. He does not always just, you know, see the people as a criminal. He tried to see, as you mentioned, into the mystery of the soul. I think, you know, that also kind of inspired me.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the Poirot, Monsieur Poirot series, if you guys, okay, you know, sorry. I think too, there's something interesting about, I mean, maybe it was sort of that notion of the accidental in Inspector Chen being assigned to be a policeman is that in this country, at least, there's been a history of poets who were recruited by the CIA. And the notion was that they understand nuance extremely well. And so they could read between the lines, and they're sort of, they have this practiced intuition and these highly developed sort of sensibility radar for the world around them. So
yeah, you know, that's a good point, right? Yeah, that proves. Yeah, he does have to read, you know, between the lines, you know, sometimes what it means exactly for him to do. Yeah, it happens quite a lot.
So do you want to open it up for questions?
If you want me to talk more, or if you want to ask questions, or you want me to talk in any specific, you know, field.
I'm curious, you mentioned George Simenon. Are there other authors or antecedents who influence sort of your work when you were discovering the mystery genre and deciding mystery authors that influence your understanding of the genre when you were first starting out?
Among you know, these mystery writers, two Swedish authors. I'm sorry, I'm ashamed to say, you know, I cannot pronounce their name properly because with this kind of dots above the name. I don't know how to pronounce that. I think it's Pawalu, but I do know the main character name is Inspector Martinbeck. Some people call the two like the founder of the, you know, this kind of sociological mystery genre. They are even earlier than Henning Mankell. It is true because before them, I read like, you know, Sherlock Holmes, like, you know, Agatha Christie. So when I first read them, I was a little bit surprised, you know, that the character in there, not just the main character smiling back, they're almost like anti-hero in the sense of mystery writing. They are not like, you know, all like mystery solving machines, they are real human beings. And also they are more interested in, you know, what kind of social, political, cultural circumstances the tragic take place and the investigation take place. So at least for me, you know, this kind of writing, because I wanted to write about the problem of Chinese society. Mm-hmm. So that, you know, really fit well with my you know, original intention. And ironically, I think these two were couples. I think the lady is still alive. And they were Communist Party members. They set out to write about evils of the capitalist society. But they turned accidentally, again, into very successful mystery writers. So I think they influenced me maybe more, even more than some American, like, you know, mystery writers.
Heard a couple of writers talk this week, just by chance, about languages and how knowledge of other languages influences their writing. I heard that I'm going to say this wrong, but W.S. Merwin said that poets should start out as translators. Have you ever heard anything like that?
Yeah, I read his poems.
Yeah. Do you any comment about the relationship of translation to your own work, or how it affects it?
Okay, so. It's kind of two questions.
Okay, whatever you want.
I asked you the first question first. This is a question that really interested myself. I read some works not by novelists or poets, but by some psychologist. I just forgot the name, but I even wrote a short paper on that. According to that, the language, to some extent, speaks to people. To put it in another way, because, you know, in one particular language, you have certain way of speaking, and that in turn determines or influences you how to behave. Or you can put it in another way, it's like, you know, the language like has like a subconscious mechanism in your mind. And you grew up in this mechanism, and then you behave accordingly. Like, you know, in this language system, let's say this word is positive. So you do it, but this word is negative, then you don't do it. For example, I was a translator. Now that's to your second question. There is one word I did not know how to translate into Chinese. It's a very common English word, privacy. Because privacy in the 80s was definitely a negative word. That means you have something to hide from other people. You have something to hide from the party authorities. Yes, we do have the Chinese word, like, you know, you can say that, but the connotation of that Chinese word was bad. Oh, I want my privacy. What do you mean? You like, you know, you want to hide something. You want to keep me in the dark. You must be class enemy, right? You know, engage some counter-revolution activities. So that's really, you know, the language really influences the way you speak, not just the way you speak, the write, the act, right? Now, another example I can give you, Karen, you know the word shen, right?
What's shen?
Like, you know, when we go to a Chinese restaurant, we say, oh, this dish is really shen.
Like shan, like fragrant?
No, it's like...
fresh?
It's like fresh, yeah. But it's not fresh because Chinese gourmet talk about MSG, you know that, right? It's really valuable taste,
yeah,
for Chinese food. It's almost like the highest standard if this particular dish is good because it is shen. But you don't have that word in English. You cannot find that word. Fresh is not shen. No, it's not. It's not. So in turn, you can also say, because we have this kind of language, this kind of word, we even demand the production of MSG, large quantity. Sometimes I eat, you know, with a lot of American or Western friend. So sometimes it's really hard to try explain what shen is. They don't care. Yeah, this is good enough. Why we bother? But some people even, you know, have problem with MSG, right? Some Chinese restaurant even says no MSG. But for Chinese, yeah, this is a must, because when we were born, our parents said, yeah, this is shen. And then you just grew up with this word, and then you behave accordingly. So that's something quite interesting. So again, you know, maybe a little bit more about your question. I do believe each language has its own linguistic sensibility. So, you know, if you compare Chinese poetry to American poetry, you can find, you know, the way you feel can be quite different. So maybe it's worthwhile, and that's something I'm trying to do, to combine, you know, the different linguistic sensibilities in our writing. It does not work all the time, but sometimes it works and it makes you very happy.
It seems like that's an interesting way, too, for you to bridge your life living between two cultures.
Exactly.
Between two
exactly.
worlds.
Yeah, exactly.
And not unrelatedly in the same city where T.S. Eliot was born, yes? Same
oh, place. Yes, yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'll just keep that. Yeah. He has to teach, so.
Would you say your first novel sort of evolved accidentally into a mystery? Would you just say more about that process? What the accident was, I guess.
See, they're often working on their first novel here,
yes.
right? And,
yes.
and the issue is you're confronted with the white page and you say to yourself, well, now I get to write a novel. What on earth am I going to do here? How am I going to put it together? What am I going to draw from? You know, there's so many decisions that can make you feel paralyzed.
Yes, you know, with my first novel, I think, you know, I did not have any experience writing fiction. So first I produced like some chapters. It's just my way of writing, like, you know, I like, you know, poetry. So I have this main character, he's intellectual, and I want him to be intellectual because I want him to think about why and how things happen in China, right? Not just a passive observer, but I want him to think. But it's really a fragmented mass, like, you know, this chapter and that chapter. What's the connection? What's the connection? Also, I think I had a problem about, I don't want this main character talk about why and how things happen in China all the time, right? It's too mechanical. So I did wrote a few chapters. I did write a few chapters about, you know, this kind of discussion, but it's too laboring. You know, it's like you have a feeling, oh, you just do that for that purpose. So I want to find a more natural way, you know, like explore how this and why happens. Because if, let's say, the main character is just a college professor, he can talk, you know, in some lectures about things. But it's difficult for us to imagine, like, in his daily life, he explores all of these all the time, right? So then, I cannot remember exactly how one day suddenly I got the idea about, like, you know, maybe I can change the identity of this main character into a cop. For a cop, it's more natural for him to explore, right? A cop, you need to, you know, ask all kinds of questions, right? And for a cop, you can also have access to some information, especially in China, some secret information. And of course, it's natural for him to explore. And more importantly for me, it's like, it gave me a ready-made structure. I don't have to worry about, like, you know, how I have to begin, how I have to end. Of course, I do have trouble with my second one, because with my second novel, my editor said to me, well, your first novel was okay, you know, because we know it's your first novel, right? But with your second novel, you have to be more like a mystery. You definitely have a body at the beginning. You definitely could have killed more people. So it's kind of a struggle. Yeah. But I remember, you know, with the second one, I didn't reach a compromise with him, with the editor. I said, well, I can't have a body. Because she said to me, even if the body has nothing to do with your investigation, we still need a body. I said, no, if I want to put a body there, the body must have something to do with the case, right? So finally we work something out.
That would be a funny mystery where it's clear there's a mystery going on, but the main character's not investigating it. So there's a body, but they have better things to do that morning, and then, you know.
He should just say to me, you need to have a hook at the very beginning, mm-hmm. so the body can be irrelevant to the investigation.
But it's interesting, so you're saying that when you began, you had this notion almost thematically about what you wanted to do in the work, right? You wanted to write about China and how it was changing, and you also had a sensibility yourself about the kind of character who would think the way that you could channel, right? Mm-hmm, who was mm-hmm. intellectual in many ways and sort of aware of a literary view of the world, let's call it. And so with those things in mind, you start to think, what's the best vehicle for setting that into motion, right, without it seeming mechanical or unengaging emotionally and in terms of, you know, narrative tension, right? Mm-hmm. So rather than a series of lectures issued by a professor, which, as everybody knows here, is incredibly dull, you instead say, okay, well, you know, it's almost if A equals B and B equals C, then A equals C. So here's this detective that answers the questions, the sort of pragmatic questions about narrative tension, but at the same time allows you the vehicle to pursue the things you want to. So there's this way in which the form is a reflection of the content, right? You have themes you want to cover, and those dictate almost the form then the writing takes.
Yeah, you can say that, but it came to me gradually. Like, you know, for the first novel, I was not even fully aware of that. You know, why and how I was doing that. Like, you know, some discussion about why and how, I just found it's much more natural for him to discuss with his partner, right? You know, they need to discuss why he did this and you know why it happened in this tragic way. It's natural for them to talk over the investigation, but if I want to write another form of novel, I need to find some other way to do that. So I tried with the first one without really knowing that I was going to continue with this kind of particular format, with this kind of particular theory. So it's, again, it's accidental because she wanted me to write three books. And after two or three books, not only my American publisher, but like, you know, French, Italian, other publishers, they jumped in. Okay, you have go on with this inspector. So we, what other, you know, murder we can solve in the next book. So it's just happened last night.
What's most difficult about the form for you? Where do you find that it feels constraining, or where do you find you struggle with it?
Well, one thing I try to do, I try to put each of my inspection book in a specific background. So it's like something above the case, so to speak. For example, I have one book. The title is Don't Cry Pai Lake. It's really about the pollution in China. And so, but it of course you have to write a murder story, right? Somebody had to be killed. Otherwise my publisher would never let me off the hook. But at the same time, I also want to explore not just who killed who. In that sense, pollution is not just of the lake. The pollution is also of human mind. And it's kind of you know, symbolic of each other. And that sometimes is difficult. Because sometimes editors will say to me, yeah, we love your work, but this is like a little bit too much, you know, into something else.
Right. So in other words, one of the difficulties is just reader expectation if you're working within a genre. They say, well, we know what we like and when we see it and it always has this.
Yeah, and you think, well, come on,
why does it always have to have that? Doesn't that get repetitive?
Yeah, that's my question is, did you feel like, so you said you wrote 10 books in the series.
Mm-hmm.
And so your first book sort of came out of a desire to write about Chinese society.
Yes.
As you proceeded through the 10 books, did you feel like you could continue doing both those things, making them more like mysteries, like your publisher was asking, and at the same time making comments about the changes in Chinese society and addressing the kinds of issues you wanted to address?
Yeah, you know, one of the tricks I have mentioned, at least for myself, is to put this murder case in a specific social or cultural background. Let me give you another example. One of inspection novel, the title is When Red is Black. Okay. Actually, the original idea came to me, nothing to do with mystery. I went to Qingming, you know, the grave sweeping festival in China during, I think that's April 4th, that's the kind of holiday people just go to your parents or your ancestors' grave, you know, to play or something like that. So one year I went to my father's grave in Shuzhou. Now my father was a captain. For many years, what capitalist in China just means, okay, if you had a business, you have a small factory, that's That's my father's case. He had a small factory before 1949.
Mm.
That's a year communists took over the power. So after 1949, Chairman Mao has a class theory, class struggle theory, like, you know, landlords, capitalists, rightists, you know, these people belong to the black class. Basically, that means you are not one of us. You are not one of the people. So you can be punished any time. And my father suffered quite a lot after 1949, and especially during the Cultural Revolution. And of course, in Mao's class theory, we also have the red classes, okay? So that's like the workers, farmers, poor farmers. If you're rich, you're still black, okay? Poor farmers and the soldiers, okay? You are red. That means you are one of us. You are part of the people. So politically trustworthy. So when I went to my father's grave, that was after the ending of the Cultural Revolution, and things changed quite a lot in China. Now, nowadays, we all know in China, if you're rich, you're great, right? You're rich, you're glorious. That's Deng Xiaoping said, it's glorious to be rich. So suddenly, if you're a capitalist, it's fine. And if you make more money, that's even better. So then I thought, you know, all the suffering my father went through is for nothing, right? It's like a joke. It's like a joke.
Mm.
And at the same time, for these red people, nowadays in China, if you are a worker earning a little, not much, you are nobody. You're almost like black, right? Of course, it does not mean like people will, the government will, like, you know, look down on you. But the other people will say, oh, you don't have a house, you don't have a car, right? So it's total reversal of the ideology and also reverse, you know, of social status. So I suddenly think, well, maybe, you know, I can write a book about tragedy happens in this kind of upside down of the society. Not just about some people like my father suffered for nothing, but also about some people who used to be red, used to be so politically glorious, so, you know, proud, but now they, because if they have no money, they were nobody. And it makes sense for tragedy happen, you know, in this kind of circumstance. And I do know, like, you know, quite a number of tragedy in China happened in this kind of reversal. So that's how, you know, I came to write this murder story. Yes, it's a murder story, but at the same time, it's a murder story that happens in this kind of reversal. Now, when this book was translated back into Chinese by somebody else, it's kind of funny, they said to me, no, we cannot keep the same title. I said, why? They said, well, you know, in Chinese language, red and black is still too politically sensitive. So we want to use a neutral title, something like a garden or something. So,
he used like beige and denim. But I like what you say here, because also you're illustrating the writer's eye, which is rather than say, well, my father suffered in this way, so therefore I'm going to write about somebody who was deemed a capitalist,
mm-hmm.
who then, you know, has their fortunes fall or and then reverse. You took almost the opposing point of view, right?
Mm-hmm.
You took the very people who had created so much or were associated with the agony visited
uh-huh.
on your father, and you wrote from their point of view about how things have reversed, right? About how red is the new black.
I had my inspection go to the grave himself, so standing by there and think a little bit about that. But actually, some idea that's in my mind as well, yes.
Well, okay, so it's 1 o'clock. We can do a couple more questions. If people have to leave, that makes sense, but we'll do a few questions and then we can kind of wrap up.
Thank you.
Could you talk a little bit about what it's like to write in a language that isn't your first language, and also the experience of, because you do speak Chinese, reading your own work in Chinese when?
Yes, I do. I still read and speak and even write in Chinese. Mm-hmm. And I just recently wrote a piece for New York Times. They have a Chinese version, so I did that in Chinese. Again, it's my personal. I don't think I write most of the time nowadays in English, but I don't think the other language, the Chinese language, is just like shut up, forgotten in the corner of your mind. It's still there. It's still working in a subconscious way. I remember George Orwell has said in an essay, I think it's English Language and Politics, right? Mm-hmm. That's a well-known essay. I think he says to write is to avoid the cliché at any cost. And there are certainly a lot of cliches nowadays, right? Politics, otherwise, yeah. But the funny thing, in my case, often the cliche in one language, when you translate it directly,
he's genius.
Another language. It's just I'm lazy because it's my second language, right? I'm not that confident I can compete with native writers. I speak English all the time. Back home, I speak Shanghainese with my wife, with my mother-in-law, and they watch Chinese TV all the time. So I don't think I can really compete with native American writers. No, not in that sense. But if anything I can call as my advantage is I do have this kind of different language at the back of my mind. Some kind I can try to use some of that as long as it's readable. And actually it can make the language quite fresh in a way. Yeah. Even though it might be cliche in Chinese, right?
Any additional comments about, since you've talked about the politics and the way the powers that be changed their relationship to the people over time, that's maybe happening here a little bit. Mm-hmm. what advice do you have for the writers?
Can you bring some historical context to the election of Donald Trump, I think is the question.
It's again in that George Orwell essay. He said this kind of political language is bad because it made people lazy, not thinking, just cliches, right? Mm-hmm. Because it's language overused. Mm-hmm. At least for some people, they just take at the face value. Yeah, that's it, and it's bad, it's good, and it's not. And in that way, the government, or I would say Chinese government made much more than anywhere else, try to pull people's leg in that way, this kind of political language. So that's And I think that's also where, you know, we as writers can try to do something effective. You know, writing a language, maybe not that familiar, maybe not that politically correct, maybe not that easily acceptable, but at least because, yeah, that's something I never thought of before. So people will think, will open people's eye. Yeah? We can also look things from the other perspective. I think language sometimes can be very controlling, like, you know, some word used can be negative, but the same concept, if you use another word for it, can be positive, right? So that's kind of trick, play a lot. I may not be, you know, expert in English language, but, you know, in Chinese language, this kind of trick plays all the time.
That's fascinating. I love that notion too, because it's sort of like, you know, when you read a cliche and it's superficial, even though there's some deeper meaning, but it's been buried in just the sound. And our notion is essentially to excavate meaning from language, and then offer that to people for contemplation. I mean, I mean that's like the profound mission, I think, of really any artist, even if they're not even if it's not in the written form.
Yeah, you can say that. You can say that. It's like, you know, it's so easy, like cliche, everybody knows the means, right? So you don't think. And that's not my idea, it's George Orwell's idea. So you don't think, you just take it, and then the government, you know, the connotation, not, you know, the
literal.
Yeah, connotation that come with it, mm-hmm. and then pull people in. Sometimes I used to have a joke with my daughter, that's quite a few years ago, okay, when she was really small, and she's trying to learn, you know, the Chinese language as well. She asked me one question about Mickey Mouse, and I remember that joke, sorry about that, and she said, in Chinese, why we cannot say Mi Haozi, we have to say Mi Lao Shu. So it's really started me thinking. So then I said to her, I said, well, yeah, we say Mickey Mouse, but we don't say Mickey Rat, right? That's the same thing. But the rat is more negative. Mouse, it's neutral, right? We cannot say like it's necessary, like a positive. But in, especially in politicians' way of using language, they sometimes use this kind of cliche or this kind of phrase or this kind of word that carry either like, you know, the positive or negative meaning. And then you just take it, oh yeah, that's good. Oh, that's bad. You don't think about that.
Mm-hmm. All right, so maybe one more question and we'll finish up. Barbara, do you have one?
I was just wondering, the book that you have in front of you is the sort of prehistory, I guess, before the series.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you were talking about how right before you wrote the first book, it was the 80s and 90s, and you left China and you couldn't return. I'm wondering if any of that sort of history is reflected in that book.
Yes, it's not only like the 80s, it's like in his childhood. Inspector Chen's mother is a Buddhist believer, and she kind of believes in, I'm not a believer in that sense, but I do believe in a lot of things happen in one's life. You know, maybe something very small. At that time, it means nothing. But many years later, it can be very important in deciding what you do. So in this is more like collection of linked story. Something happened to Chen in his childhood. Something happened to Chen's neighbor. Something to his family member. Of course, something happened to him as well, right? And of course, something like happened to him in the 90s when he just joined the police force. So, you know, on the surface, they may not be really related, but when you put them together, like you can see, you know, how a person's career or life, you know, or past can be influenced by this kind of Buddhist philosophy. Even, you know, like a drink of water can be like they use the term karma, right? It's all related. It's all related. And also, I think you in your information sheet, like in some of you have read, you know, the one story about China pollution, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I have to say one thing about that. It was done really in a hurry, because it's a magazine called World Policy. At that time, I was helping my daughter moving to San Francisco. So I was in San Francisco. They call me, they say, okay, we want you to write a piece about China pollution. I said, no, I cannot. I'm not expert, right? And I did write, you know, a book about, you know, the Dong Kwai Tai Lake. But for the reason I mentioned, it's like a murder story. It's not really an academic book about, but they say, it's fine, you can write a short story. And we gave you like 10 days or something like that. So it was really, really done in a hurry. And I hope you don't judge me with this story. And because the reason I want to mention that, I'm kind of expanding that into novella so that can make things a little bit better, you know, in terms like quality writing. But having said that, I want to say sometime, this may also apply to you as well, sometime, you know, the other people give you the idea, the assignment, sometime we may also make it work. So that's not totally a bad thing. Also during my stay, you know, helping moving, it's really busy, I wrote another piece. It's also like assignment from Louis Vuitton, you know, the brand. They want me to write piece. I said, no, I never use your product. I have no knowledge about your product, right? So how can I do that? Well, they say, whatever, okay. If you can bring your inspection into that picture, we'll be grateful. But I did, and it came out, and they were very happy. And for that one, actually, I'm a little bit happy because it's just some lucky strike, you know. So it's sometimes it's, I would say it's not always a bad idea, you know, to be pushed to do
right,
something.
Right.
Yeah. But sometimes it's like, you know, the smog smother sky, right? That one, it was done too much of a rush.
Well, the novels are outstanding, so I hope you, yeah, I appreciate the point, but I hope you don't feel that we're judging you in a way to make you feel defensive at all. I mean, the novels are a delight. I encourage you guys to check them out. They're really quite good. And well, this has been delightful. I can't thank you enough for such thoughtful answers, and I hope this is of use to you all too, and in various ways as, you know, you continue to sail through the doldrums of novel writing, where the air is heavy and there's this sense of expectation. But thank you, it's been a total
thank
delight.
You.
Thank you.
All right. and now sandwiches too. You know what's very funny
is that
I was sitting here and I was really hungry, and then I realized everything is wrapped in incredibly loud containers, and I didn't want to sort of make too much noise over here.
Yes, that would be sad. And she would grow up and write a story about me.
What's the word?
I'm not sure what I have to do.
Well, but see.